So tonight, and we're going to talk about depression and how to overcome it. Number one, so first of all, we talk about depression. As accordingly, Western medical treatment believes that it is some kind of an imbalance of the hormones in the body. Okay? Whether it is true or not, I'm not in a position to tell you about the medical depression because I'm not a doctor. But what I'm saying now is with regards to the kind of depression that people face in our everyday daily lives. Well, we get depression in our life. Yes, we do have depression. And we are seemingly normal people. But in the eyes of realized beings, we are rather depressed beings. So what are the signs to look out for to know whether we are, or to know if somebody is depressed? Some of the very clear signs, but in which other people may not easily recognize, people having a particular obsession over something. Okay, an obsession over something. It's actually a kind of depression. Then the question is, why do you say that? Because nothing should be just be sprouted irresponsibly. Okay? So a particular obsession with something shows that the mind, or we say soul, of a particular person has a particular absence of something that someone is seeking. So let's just use Buddhism as a good example. There are many people who are lay people who believe they can do much better than the monks and the nuns, who believe they, who definitely some of them who can chant better than the monks and nuns, who can do work better than the monks and nuns, and this, and they become very self-righteous, and then they have their own set of beliefs and stuff like that, and they do very well in the spiritual field. But if you ask them to become a monk or a nun, they will say no, they will say not necessary, they will say this, they will not, they will say that. Such is maybe a kind of depression, because maybe if it is something that could be measured in the outside world, maybe this person cannot succeed. But if in a spiritual world, so something that can be easily shown to be doing well on the outside, like to be able to chant well, to be able to dress in a particular fashion well, or to be able to this and that, then because we cannot do well here, so then we will strive to do well in the religious field. Then somehow someone, even though on the outside looks very, very spiritual or very religious, inside always there's some kind of feeling of competition. There's still a lot of complaining and justifying and blaming. Then it becomes dangerous. So what is depression? And of course, this particular example I'm giving is with regards to religious or spiritual practice. But if you look, you know, some people just want to keep on eating, or keep on cooking, or keep on clubbing, or keep on... it's the same, huh? I'm just saying that there's an obsession over a particular thing. Or some people just keep on bitching, or keep on being sarcastic, or keep on wanting to prove themselves, or to keep on saying how last time how good they were. These are all different forms and aspects of depression. Some may be because of old age, some may be because of hormonal differences, some may be because of body inside have some mineral or vitamin deficiency. Some people say that, you see. My question was, so far, what I have observed, when people are diagnosed with depression, they give them they say medicine, but actually drugs. After the person eat, they become sedated. And so they cannot do the things that they feel that they want or they need to do. So on our side, on our ordinary life, we do not have this kind of clinical depression. Then we really need to think about our own practice. First of all, let's become rooted again to deeply reflect upon the teaching of Buddha. It is said that as long as we focus towards enlightenment, it becomes Dharma. As long as we, the least is, as long as we focus or aim the goal towards next life, it is still at least Theravada Dharma. Okay? But if we, anything, look very closely, anything that we are depressed about, why is it not Dharma? It's because it cannot be measured towards the next lives and the future lives. The next thing will be everything that could be measured, can be measured, will be measured, and this depression steps in. What kind of clothes you wear, what brand of clothes you wear, what handbag you take, what wallet you use, okay? What car you drive, what house you stay, everything that can be measured, it becomes a kind of a competition. Just making people more not self-aware, but maybe some kind of insecurity. And so there's always some kind of a, even though it's a kind of a awareness, but also that is used to, is challenge and channel to the wrong way. So when we say depression, always, if you look and observe, who has the most depression? You want to know? Yeah? We observe, okay? Tonight you go and observe something. You want to know who has the most depression? Politicians. Politicians have depression. Right? Politicians are always blaming, complaining, justifying, always putting other people down, make themselves look good and this. Even though outside don't look like depression, they feel so insecure. So that itself is also one some kind of depression. So what is the best Dharma for ourselves, for this life, to future life, towards enlightenment, the best medicine? What is the best medicine? The best medicine truly is the Buddha's teaching, the Mahayana Dharma, based on the two turning, first and second turning of the wheel of Dharma. So today I little bit explain about the first and second turning on the wheel of Dharma. If we talk about the first turning on the wheel of Dharma, then very clearly it is talking about the first teaching of Buddha, talk about the Four Noble Truths, right? Truth of suffering and truth of happiness. Then break down the truth of the truth of suffering, truth of the cause of suffering, truth of happiness, and truth the path leading to it. So this is the first turning on the wheel of Dharma. But somehow, somewhere, it may give you and me and everybody the idea that I exist and you exist. We exist truly. We really exist, that's why we need to find a way out. Correct? Hello. I give you a very good example. Let's use shit. Okay? I think something that can in touch with your daily life is the best. Okay? Does shit exist? Huh? How does shit exist in your mind? Say. What is the form of shit? What comes to your mind immediately? Diarrhea shit or sausage shit? Huh? Sausage. Most people think sausage like shit, right? Because you like to eat sausages, right? It's the intestine lining of animals. Do you know that? The sausage lining, if you go to the butcher and buy intestine, they pull that transparent like thing, opaque like that thing, that's the intestinal lining of the animal. Right? So I should have left the details out, isn't it? Huh? And so somehow shit seems to be in your mind, that fixated form, shape, color, smell. Right? Yeah. What's the smell of Indian shit versus your shit? Huh? You wanna know? I tell you, okay? Because when I live in India, every day eat spice and curry. Result very different from back home. Yeah, it has an extra spice to it. Right? Yeah. So we take shit as the form of being real. But when the moment you splash water on it, it disintegrates. Somehow it becomes swooshy sludge. And more water, it becomes watery. Then after that, there is no... If you use it to fertilize the land, then the shit and the earth mix together, and there is... You cannot differentiate shit and the soil. It becomes in oneness. Right? Similarly, for us, for me, personally, for me, the first turning of the wheel of Dharma, which is all this thing there, so makes me think that there seems to be a real I, the real I. That's why I need to be free. First turning on the wheel of Dharma, I need to have the path to happiness, because there is an I. There is need to be happy. You understand? There is the I that needs to be happy. Because the I is now suffering. The truth of suffering and the truth of cause of suffering. So therefore becomes, you tell the I that there is a happiness and a path leading to it. So it is the swing. What is the second turning on the wheel of Dharma? in that aspect, the second turning of the wheel of Dharma is in the Heart Sutra. The Heart Sutra says, come give me the English one. There is one. Basically, it says, therefore, the five skandhas are also, the term here, so basically, so basically, the five skandhas, the five sight, smell, hearing, tasting, feeling, is also empty. Also empty, this term, empty of nature, is telling us, first, our happiness, the first of the happiness usually come by what? By what content? Visual content. Alright? Yeah. First is the visual content. You must look like nice. Right? Then feels like nice, sounds like nice, tastes like nice, touching like nice. Okay? So then there's what they say. Seems like there is something like is a real, right? Because you can see, you can taste, you can touch. But in the second week, the second turning of the wheel of Dharma based on Heart Sutra, all these things, they are not real. Okay, this thing, why is it not real? Let's just demote ourselves to become earthworms. Let's all now suddenly pretend we are earthworms. Do earthworms have eyes? Can they eat? Can they hear? Do earthworms have ears? But can they, how do they know? Huh? Alright. The whole body, the skin is feeling vibration. Okay. So, it's the same. Actually, I wanted to use one of you to become the scapegoat to teach the Heart Sutra. Yeah? I want to blindfold and use a paper bag and cover your head so there's no cheating. Yeah? But that's my own very interesting way of teaching the Heart Sutra. Okay? But right now, just pretend you are an earthworm. So close your eyes. I want you to close your eyes. Don't play cheat, okay? Close your eyes. It's very simple. I won't do anything to you. Now that when you close your eyes, do you suddenly feel that your other senses are sharpened? Hearing is sharpened. Feeling is sharpened. okay? A particular aspect of, don't open your eyes, close. A particular aspect in you somehow now refocus on something else that is available now. One that is not available, since you know it is no longer functioning, if your eyesight is gone, it is no longer functioning, that mind refocuses on whatever application that is still successful within for you in the body. So, now you can open your eyes and pretend you are a human being again. Pretend you are a human being, because you are not one. Right? Why do I say pretend you are a human being? Because if you truly believe that you are always going to be a human being, you are going to be so depressed. Because you are a human being body, you are not a human being because you are only living in your human body. You understand? You are living in your human body. This is what the Heart Sutra mainly now refocus. If you are not living in your human body, will you have eyes, ears, nose, mouth, body, mind? Okay, so it is very important for us to recite the Heart Sutra. Okay? So when we say, when ordinarily we have so much problems or depression or this and that, and it is very important that you now have to close your eyes, sit down and close your eyes now. Look aware that you are a human being now, but the moment you close your eyes and everything, then you bring to you are mind. What are you? What are you? Very important. What are you? Who are you? If you are going to live in your past, you are sad case. There are some people, maybe young time got molested, and forever they live in that. I got molested in the past. Maybe young time they did some mistake, then the whole life they say, oh, I did that mistake in the past. I'm bad, I'm a sinner. Sometimes they got, young time maybe they got raped, young time maybe they got bullied, and young time, now the most ridiculous thing come to me now is, I feel, the young time didn't get opportunity, but now fully in oneness with them, Star Wars. I see on Facebook my school classmates, they can afford it now. They wear all the things, they live their childhood dream. In my mind is like, gosh. Okay? So really, we have to drop this depressive human being mode. Because this human being mode, the moment, you just, now you drop being a human, now think that. How many of you have pets? Have pets. Okay. For those of you who have a pet, you become your pet now. Close your eyes and become your pet. Take the identity. If not, I want all of you to become goldfish. Close your eyes. Okay? Why not all of you become... Sorry. All of you become... Okay, you become Nemo. Become the clownfish. Now all of you are clownfish, swimming in the coral, amongst the coral. Nice? Beautiful? You are going to be delicious. Right? Now change. Change body. Now you become octopus. Okay? Your whole body becomes pure muscle. No fats. You're very intelligent. Big brain, big head. You don't need a body, a border about your body. You are only a head, eyes, and tentacles. Talk to me, you are intelligent. Your mind, if your mind, human mind now, gets so used to only want to achieve things and think and don't feel and just do and achieve, your next life you're going to become an octopus. So many of you, please get used to it now. You're going to be reborn as an octopus. Okay, and you are hiding in the nooks and cranny of in the sea. Okay? And some Korean or Japanese fishermen catch you, and then they dip you in soya sauce, and you go yucky. The next thing you know, you are chewed alive. Now let's change position. Now change form again. Now you are a dog in a rich person's house. You only get to bathe twice a week. You are well groomed, but you eat the same dog food your whole life. You may think and have thoughts, but the moment you open your mouth, not words, only barking. You slip into depression, how come? You cannot jump onto the bed and sleep like your master and your owner. Now change. You have become a city rat that loves the sewers and eat. And your favorite free restaurant is the garbage. Okay? And you have to be very, very careful of wild cats. And look, there are free biscuits available, water for you. You eat and you become very thirsty. And you drink all the water. It's rat poison, and your stomach starts to swell, and your stomach feels very bloated, and it explodes and you die. Switch again, now come back, you are a human being again. Now you are pretending that you are who you were. Okay, now you open your eyes, you are back there listening to the Dharma. When you were a dog, did your problems of you thought who you were exist? Huh? Okay. So similarly, when we talk about depression and how to overcome them, telling you ways and means and methods won't work. Doing such an exercise will. Okay. You must first feel how fortunate you are now. Because if not, it will become an escape. Oh, I close my eyes, I dissolve the sky, and what happened? And I arise as a deity, or invoke some deities to come, and then I can talk to them. Then what happens? You go crazy, you know? You somehow talking to yourself, you know? Somebody tell me, say, oh, I can talk to Tara. I say, oh, what Tara does language speak? Whatever I speak, my Tara speak. What did Tara do? Tara gave me 4D number, lottery number. Did you strike? I never buy. Are you sure? Actually, I bought number, I didn't strike. Why didn't ask Tara for your day of enlightenment? Oh, I didn't think about it, I asked about my problem. If you see Buddha, and you ask Buddha about your problem, it's such a big, lost a great opportunity, isn't it? So, first thing first, my recommendation is for us not to start saying that, oh, I arise as deity, or I can see deities, and the deities are talking to me. It's all your illusion. All your illusion. what most happened is that how you can become a spiritual, a deeper spiritual practitioner is you have to feel how fortunate you are now. Right? The other day, I went to the market to buy offerings. So I walked into the marketplace and I thought, wow, as an ordinary human being, this is bliss. This is harvest. This is bountiful. Look, I've got chicken, there's chicken meat. I don't need to kill chicken meat. And mutton and beef. And there's a lot of seafood. Look at look at all kinds of fish, all kinds of prawns. Oh, look at all kinds of vegetables. It's a bountiful harvest. It's God's blessing. There's a great abundance. These some people choose to think like that. Then, now I switch. I'm fish. I'm that fish. The kind of nasi lemak fish, they say, oh, my corpse is there. I got suffocated amongst all the other brothers and sisters. I still can see consciousness still there in the fish. How you know? You poke the fish, then the meat still rebound, bounce back immediately. The consciousness still there. Eyes still staring at me. Touching my body, molesting me. See, open up, see my gills, see whether it's still red. Of course. Huh? So there's two ways. One is to think, oh, there's abundance, wow. Then wastage is not a problem. When there's abundance, what happens? You choose only the best. When you don't have, even those that can so-called barely make the mark, or an expired one is good. Better than nothing, correct? So everything truly depends on the mind. Okay? For ordinary sentient beings, it is a very important that they like to create that feeling of abundance. For deeper practitioners or more seasoned, why I say more seasoned practitioners? Because a lot of tears crying out already. Then the tear is salty, so you get seasoned by its own tears. Salt not by your guru put salt on you, but because from your own tears are salty, so marinated. And then you do work, you perspire a lot. So there's oil and salt, and you're quite tasty actually. Huh? Right. So for the seasoned practitioner, so if you don't do work and if you don't practice and you don't face difficulties, okay, and you don't do volunteer work and you don't work with other people, you don't feel difficult, you're not practicing. You're just enjoying your human existence while your human body is still available. I know there are some people who know extremely spoiled and fortunate. There's some people who every which day is a shopping day, every which day is a movie day, every which day is some day. Some people say quite many people are like that. Yeah. So they ask me, how do I live my day? I say every day. Every day is a holy day. Right? Every day is a holy day and a holiday. Holiday from being a hell being, holiday from being an animal, holiday from being a hungry ghost, holiday from being an angry God, an angry, righteous and judgmental God, and holiday from being a long life God. Right? So, some people have yaksha-like, or demigod-like behavior. Very beautiful, very judgmental, easily angry, very wants to have a beautiful things. Mind is very tough. Have a lot of righteousness and expectation. So these are generally yaksha-like, demigod yaksha-like behavior. Right? They're another category. Well, not like that. They're just very proud. They want to look beautiful. They don't want to mix with other people. They're in a class of their own and this and that. Oh, then they're very much like the long life gods. And there are people who like to live amongst their own community, they run this and that, they want to maintain their identity, their style, and this and that. Oh, next life is similar, become animal. Right? You heard of the term, say, birds are the same feather fly in a flock. Isn't it? Same community, ma? Same type, ma? Same type of fish swim together, right? Same, all the same one, all the one to another. Huh? Okay. So there are many things that if we really we observe, if really we observe very very clearly, actually our depression and our problems are quite ridiculous, isn't it? But truly we reflect our daily problems, our daily situations, our daily depressions and unhappiness, our righteousness, and it's totally ridiculous. Right? But what to do? So now I teach you. You want to know? When children come and play with you, what do you do? You become a child and play the young. You become like the child and play again. Similarly, if you live amongst humans, you are a pretend human. Inside, you should become body of deity, speech is mantra, mind is wisdom. Then you are really a hidden yogi of yoginis. But right now, we are totally opposite. Outside we show, I am, you know who am I now? Right, some people are saying, do you know who am I? Oh, I don't know who you are, that's why you are good. Say, I also don't know who am I, that's why. The other day I saw one very good, very good short clip. There's this teacher says, hand up your examination, what do you call? Script. So student late by 10 seconds or something. Then he asked the teacher, do you know who am I? Teacher said, no. So that's good. He put it inside and he walked away. You don't know who it is. Yeah. Because examination may be put by number, right? Identification is number, no name or whatever. So yeah, I thought that's very nice. Yeah. So really, we always, totally opposite, we are trying to find our identity as human being. We really must release that identity as we are human being. Okay? And so then some people may say, this is ridiculous practice. If you release identity as a human being, then you become, you are not rooted. But precisely, you should uproot yourself from hell, uproot yourself from hungry ghosts, uproot from animal, uproot from human, uproot from asuras or demigods, and uproot from long life gods or the gods. Then you can be free from samsara. Right? Later you look, take a close look at the wheel of samsara over there in the temple there. Okay, actually that seems like one a lot of death like this, you know, seems like with flesh, you know. Yeah. Really maybe they should change to skeleton. Holding it, because like this telling you all these things within samsara. Sixth realm of samsara have the nature of impermanence and death. So we must experience our own death in our daily life, the death of our own fixated identity and ego. Actually, really easy to say, and also easy to do. Right? The best thing is if you have some pets at home, maybe even a goldfish or turtle. If you are really bad mood, they say, how you become? Change position. I think turtle very happy to change position with you. Right? Dog very happy to change position with you. Correct? What does the dog want? The dog only want two things, you know? Food and love. Correct? Dog goes for this. To us it's a need, but to them it's not just their need, it's their want, it's their everything, it's their heaven and earth. Right? So this is very important for us to go deeper, to have a more seasoned practice. When we say talk about depression and the methods of overcoming it, or what kind of food to eat and this and that, avoid all things that come from animal is the best. Right? If you cannot, slowly. And if we are still eating, we should always pray for the animal. Right? How many omelet have you all done? Can you all report? I need you to submit your swastika papers by end of this year. Okay, submit as one, and then the agent will collect, and then we will start to pack them in already. Okay, and if there's not enough, office need to print. Okay?
Yeah.
Because if not, I think you all didn't do anything. Okay? I didn't forget. Yeah, I really more than millions. But for, of course, for you, easy, ridiculous life. Eating, shopping, movie, and then work, every day, just some very petty things, human things. Really, when it comes to benefiting others, how to have a human life again if this life you don't benefit other human beings? Correct? Right? If you really just take from other beings by eating their flesh or trading with them, then next life you will become like them. Okay, so really if we talk about deeper practice, then it somehow must go deeper inside us, have that experience. You know, if we say that, if I tell you, your next life become this and that, no use. You just close your eyes, you look at the animal, and then you say, now I change. Now, maybe some of you become flying cockroach, or lizard. Like when you're about to die, then maybe you're afraid of lizard, then suddenly a lizard appears. You think that, oh, I've got a good prayer, good Mary. Then suddenly you see a lizard on the wall, then you go, oh, I'm so scared. Then the lizard triggered all your fear and everything about lizard. Definitely your next life is going to be lizard. Right? Even got Buddha's name by the side, your mind totally absorbed by the lizard. Does that happen? If it doesn't happen, I throw a cockroach at you. What happened? Huh? Your mind totally absorbed by the cockroach, right? Unless you're not a cockroach, like Auntie Phyllis. She catch the cockroach by the wing, man, give you. Yeah. Huh? Or lizard, you know, lizard. Take a lizard. Some people are afraid of lizard, yeah. I like lizard. Yeah, I taught my son to put a lizard in a next stick box. And then we pet the lizard. Nice and cold, the lizard. Yeah, and it catch by the tail, wiggle, wiggle, the tail comes out. And then it grows again. Yeah. Sounds scary, isn't it? Huh? Scary. Who's afraid of lizard? Oh. Who's afraid of cockroach? Everybody afraid of something, isn't it? Huh? Yeah. So, really, don't be too confident when somebody say, oh, I have a refuge, hope, my life, this and that, really. I'm telling you now. You don't know where you die makes a difference. At home, if there's a flying cockroach, you know, you're going to die. Don't you want to meditate? Then suddenly a fly. Go away, fly, go away. Then the anger comes up. Fly, fly. Fly. You understand? So many people say, no, seems like very easy. Huh? Yeah. They can talk what and sing song very well, no? Really, it's not the case. Right? So really, you really want to, we really need to prepare for our death. Right? So this is very important. Preparation for death. Because if we don't prepare for death, they are very simple, only 8 stages to death. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Okay? We got 8 fingers, right? We have 8 fingers and 2 thumbs. Okay? Very easy, right? 8 fingers and 2 thumbs, right? 8 fingers and the 2 stages to enlightenment. Generation stage and completion stage. That's right. 8 fingers and 2 thumbs. Yeah. Oh my gosh, I told the secret. I'm not supposed to tell. Forget it. Okay? Right? So that's why you got 8 fingers and 2 thumbs. There's only 8 stages of death. Right? Of course, now is not the time to teach that. I'm gonna make you all pay for it when I teach. We should. I thought of opening a restaurant, a small cafe, under temple. If in future it's possible, then the dining table, bottom the cafe is a coffin. Yeah, and a glass on top. Then eating vegetarian food. Yeah, and some big coffin there for you to lie down. Yeah, very nice. Very good idea. I'm thinking, because you, definitely one day you're going to sleep inside. Right? Unless your karma is so bad that you are just going to be wrapped in plastic bag. Even coffin don't have. Huh? Isn't it? Hello?
Yes.
Very morbid, right? Huh? Yeah. Then maybe we serve the food and put in a miniature coffin. Very nice. Really. Right? And this is better than some Taiwanese restaurant where everything they put in a toilet bowl, right? Yeah. There's some crazy everything, all the food, the curry put in the toilet bowl. Really look like you're eating shit. Yeah. They have everything served in the toilet bowl, water closet. Right? So, if you don't believe me, yeah, you go to restaurant, toilet bowl restaurant. I want to make coffin funeral restaurant. Yeah, I feel, it's good. If I please look into the matter. Then we put there, you know, donation of coffin to third world countries. If you want to donate a coffin, sign up there. Correct? Yeah, I feel this very good idea. All the people, you know, they live their human life shunning death. Right? We must live human life prepared for new body. But to go through the new body, you must first let the old body die. Good idea? Yeah. Very nice. So really we need them, you know, this coffin and then you know the bench. There's no individual seat. The cover is the coffin, the bench is the coffin cover. You know, coffin cover? No, not the Chinese coffin, Western coffin. Or the third world country coffin. We import the real coffin and the cover of the coffin become the bench, the seat, top, yeah. And then the bottom put the coffin, the coffin holder, the holder, use that. Yeah, cheap and good. Nobody want this kind of thing, but I like. Right, exactly. Prepare. Sooner or later you're going to use it. Or your body, your human body is going to be relying on it. You may not use it, because you don't need to use a coffin. The body does, not you. Start separate your mind from your human body. Then the human existence problem. Free. There's some people say, you are Buddha. This is mystic. You have Buddha nature. You have seed of Buddha, but you are not Buddha. Why do I say that? You want to know? Okay. Is there a difference between the seed and the tree? Buddha already become tree, but we still have the seed. Now you understand? Right? But you cannot say the seed is the tree. Right? Some very, very big tree have the very smallest unimaginable seed, correct? Right? Yeah. So similarly, right now, you are not yet Buddha, but you have Buddha nature deep within you. So, Buddhist idea and thinking is vastly different from religions that follow the system of a creator god, a holy gods, you say. Okay? We have no creator god. Okay? Because for us, because when we talk about depression, it's something to do with, some people say, why God make this problem for me? If you are true, that means if you are real, and God is real, your problem is real, then there's no need to solve the problem because everything is going to be real and permanent, is it? Right? Make sense? Everything is going to be real. Chop, stamp, seal. It's permanent. So, myself cannot accept, don't accept, or reject this firm rejection of the idea of there's a God creator. Okay? So, deeper thinking upon that, there are many, many things that are very difficult to explain if there is everything is created by God. And so then you become you become totally different from what you are now. What is the total difference is that you don't think so much. Everything is God's will. God will decide. God will everything. So just praise and pray, praise and pray, praise and pray. Okay? Yourself need really to think, to check, to think, to check, to reflect, to cognize and to recognize okay, to learn and to recognize everything. Then when you die at the end of this life, it becomes not start all over again. Not start all over again. In fact, many of you, all of you have some kind of a natural imprint from previous life. That's why you have some things that you naturally like more, correct? Correct? This is because of your previous life. So this life, we have to continue that work. That's why you see how many million people in Singapore, how many actually really learn Dharma? How many actually learn Dharma? How many actually every week go and praise the God and pray and pray and pray? Many are prayers, many are sheep. Many want to be the follow guidance of the don't want to think. But Buddha's teaching, principally by letting us to recite the Heart Sutra, is the first to make you have doubt. What is the meaning of this? I have eyes, you say I have no eyes. I have ears, you say I have no ears. No mouth, no tongue, no body, no eye. Nothing. Why? What is Buddha talking about? Right? So Buddha would do these kind of things to make you, to make us rethink, relook, refill. So many of us just spending our whole lifetime just making money, enjoying life, not care so much about others, just using our mind to, the method to make our life more enjoyable, more this, more. It's not, because ultimately in the beginning, the Buddha said, all beings want happiness and not want suffering. That is the beginning of the Noble Truth. And that first of the Noble Truth, the first four Noble Truth, is suitable for all because it is very true for all beings who have the notion of identity. Right? And therefore, some things like maybe if it's other people make things, then if you will start to think that it is this other people's problem, not my problem, I don't want to get involved. But that's a big mistake. Truly later on, as you become a more seasoned and experienced practitioner, cultivator, since I don't exist and other people are still suffering in the notion of, in the deep belief and notion of I, and just not being able to dance in the between, it's totally sunk down by I, like, you know, you want to swim, but leg has a chain of, what do you call, weight. The weight, the I is the weight into samsara. No matter how you swim, you're never able to be free. You can go far, you sometimes go up, sometimes go down. That's why it's very important to recite Heart Sutra. Okay? Right? So how to be free from depression? Really just look up into the sky, see if there are any birds, you know, because bird will have bird problem, right? Dog will have dog problem, right? Fish will have fish problem, right? Human have human problem. So if you are too fixated to your idea about you being human, please rethink again. Right? Your problem right now is your human problem. Hokkien say, 做人的问题. Right? So this is the problem of human being problem, human problem. That's why we aspire to be bodhisattva. Bodhi means awakening. Okay? Sattva means sentient being. Bodhisattva, two words mean sentient being, who is go and aim towards the path of enlightenment, bodhi. Okay? But Chinese didn't say bodhisattva, say bosa. Okay? Bodhi, bosa. Bosa. Okay? Not bosa, you know. Okay? Bosa. Bodhi, bosa. You understand? Right? So really, we need... So sometimes, if you study the Dharma, if we study the Dharma for the sake of having just knowledge and knowledge, to become a knowledge holder, is like carrying many, many life. Okay? But the moment you start to reflect and experience the Dharma, then you know, there's no purpose of carrying many knives. And one knife can cut everything. Okay. So the just like a Western chef, you do have many different kind of knife. If this knife or this, that knife or that. The Chinese, they have one knife. Chinese chef only have one knife. That one knife, nobody can touch. Only he himself, he use his knife. Right? But Western chef, they have this knife or this, that knife or that, is totally their culture. Human problem. Human problem. Human culture. Culture also human. Okay? So, that's it for today. Any questions? No question? Okay, no question, please recite Heart Sutra, page 14.
The Heart Sutra. Who knows if I heard, once the Blessed One was calling in
Rajagraha, together in a great gathering of the Sangha of monks and a great gathering of the Sangha of Bodhisattvas. At the time the Blessed One entered the Samadhi and expressed his love of profound illumination. At the same time, the public is in front of the Bodhisattva of Mahasattva, criticizing the profound Mahasattva, so on his expense of the empty of nature. And through the power of Buddha, everyone's order to translate the laws of the public in the form, Bodhisattva of Mahasattva. How should the son and daughter of the country who wishes to practice the profound Prashna Parita
address from this day, Omba Adhubhisattva, the Bodhisattva of
Mahasattva, saved the landlord's honor. O Sai Prashna, the son and daughter of the family who wishes to practice the profound Prashna Parita, everyone should say this day, saying the first and last day of the nature. Form is emptiness, emptiness also is form. Emptiness is no other than form, form is no other than emptiness. In the same way, feeling, perception, information, and consciousness are emptiness. Thus, all dharmas are emptiness. There are no characteristics, there is no birth and no cessation, no familiarity and no purity. No increase and no increase. No Sariputra, emptiness, there is no form, no feeling, no perception, no formation, no consciousness, no eye, no ear, no nose, no tongue, no body, no mind, no ears, no sound, no smell, no taste, no touch, no dharma. Ignorance, no end, ignorance, not the law, no age and death, no end, no age and death, no suffering, no origins of suffering, no cessation of suffering, no path, no wisdom, no attainment, and no knowledge. Therefore, shall I go to the system that is not just and no attainment, and life against the partial part. Since there is no aspiration of the mind, there is no fear. Transcend also the end and the end of the human mind.
All of those are the three
words. I mean, the partial part. Fully awakened with us the possible true complete America. I found the great power of action comes from them, and my thought great insight, unsurpassed mantra, I have no mantra, but mantra and power of life. also is the
Lord. And the Lord is one. The Lord is the Lord. The Lord is the Lord. The Lord is happy and the Lord is lost. You must not trust and gather must rejoice and praise the Lord.
There is a short of one word. I think in the first paragraph, it says he saw the five skandhas to be empty of nature. It should be he saw the five skandhas to also be empty of nature. Okay? Yeah. The term is also is missing. Yeah. So somehow some people may think maybe also take away. Yeah. So also empty of nature and empty of nature, maybe they think there's not much difference. It's also empty of nature. Why? Because over here, what is the five skandhas? That means the five these things, right? The seeing, smelling, tasting, feeling, what is the five skandhas? To be empty of nature. Because that is in relation to the first turning of the wheel of Dharma that make people think that I am real. That's what I need. I need to go on the path of happiness. So I. But I is in relation to seeing, smelling, tasting, feeling, hearing. So the five skandhas are also empty. So these two are the correlation by just one word also. You understand? Because you know, many people don't understand Buddhism. They just say that, oh, there's human, or you want happiness, you want happiness. But then they say, this thing is real. If you want happiness, what you see must be real, hear must be real, taste must be real, feel must be real. So then now we ask ourselves, now since it is, you say, is not real, but what I'm eating, tasting, smelling, stomach ache is real. Real feeling. Why is the feeling real? It is real truly because you are still a real identity. You did not go beyond humanness. So main thing is we must go beyond being human, being in samsara. But if you become, you know, awakened, a wise adult, wise or experienced adult, you can still play with young children. You can still pretend to be a young child. You understand? So therefore, entire 84,000 teaching of Buddha there, they are there because they serve a purpose for our awakening. But they too have no identity or real nature. You understand? Even the teaching of Buddha, even the Buddha himself has no real nature. You understand? It's like saying, what is purpose of knife? What is the purpose of a knife? Huh? Is the knife real? Does the knife exist? Huh? Can the knife cut? But if I soak the knife in seawater, what happened? And then after some time, gone. Become rust, become sand or whatever. You understand? The purpose of the knife is to cut. But once there's nothing to cut, you leave the knife there, it will rust and it will be gone. So the purpose of a knife will only serve its purpose to cut. Then it becomes beneficial. If there's nothing more to cut, then that thing become white elephant. Now you understand? Similarly to Buddha, to teaching, is the same. Why we need the Dharma now? In the end, it's empty, but why we need to study and experience is because we still have so much identity, so much problem. So these are the medicinal formulas of how to cool ourselves from the heat of samsara. We are suffering from all kinds of ailments because of the heat of samsara. Body heat, all kinds of heat, headache, fever, flu, all because of samsara. Now you understand? Okay? Similarly, if you are not sick, will you eat medicine? So there's no purpose of the medicine, isn't it? Right? But does it mean the medicine is of no purpose? No. You understand? Yeah. When there is no plague, when there is no haze, nobody will walk around with a mask. Now you understand? Right? But the purpose of the mask when there is a haze is very precious. But when everything clears up, the purpose, the mask itself that you use, what do you do? Now you understand? Right? If you can see that, that's why the Heart Sutra says, all Tathagatas will rejoice. They can see and realize that then it becomes truly becomes them. Good night.